In 2004, fantasy writer Neil Gaiman wrote a short story titled The Problem of Susan, as a response to what he felt was a problematic treatment of Susan Pevensey in the last book of the Chronicles of Narnia. In the finale of The Last Battle, it's revealed towards the end that all the Pevensey children, along with their parents, have died in a train crash in England and are reunited with their friends in Aslan's country. All except Susan. She's said to be no longer a friend to Narnia, and more interested in lipstick, nylons, and invitations. Some readers have taken this idea and run with it, imagining Susan as a tortured young woman who was abandoned by God all for finding sexuality. This ignores the fact that Susan is said to have grown up to be a selfish, materialistic young woman who cares more about looking grown up than the lessons she learnt in Narnia. But that's not to say the execution wasn't problematic in and of itself. It's hard to believe that it's over 10 years since Merlin was on our screens. It showed what Camelot was like before it was Camelot. Arthur was a spoiled brat of a prince who would one day become the saintly king. Guinevere was a lowly servant girl who would one day fall in love with Arthur and become his saintly queen. Merlin himself was a lowly servant destined to become the greatest sorcerer the world had ever seen.
I had no idea you were so keen to die for it.
Trust me, I can hardly believe it myself.
There was a fourth member of the main cast as well, Morgana Pendragon, played by a just-starting-out Katie McGrath.
I'm sure you're doing everything you can.
Her counterpart in mythology, Morgan le Fay, is Arthur's evil half-sister and frequent thorn in his side. She begins the series as Arthur's adopted sister, ward of King Uther, and kind, benevolent sort who cares about the well-being of the people.
Share it out amongst the children and old people.
In this universe, magic is outlawed and punishable by death, and Morgana soon starts having visions and showing other signs of having magic herself, meaning she fears for her life under Uther's reign.
You think it's magic too? Please, brother. I just need to hear someone say it so I don't have to keep feeling like I'm imagining it.
Morgana spends the first two seasons as part of the core cast, with the show going out of its way to show her as a likeable and heroic sort.
Sometimes you've got to do what you think is right.
Her getting disillusioned with Uther happens as early as season one, brought on by seeing injustices done against people who have magic. For instance, Mordred is a young druid boy that she hides from Uther and later helps escape the kingdom.
I would not see him executed.
When Gwen's father is executed for working with a sorcerer, Morgana is so mad she tries to kill Uther over it. This comes to a head in late season 2, where she meets her evil half-sister Morgos, played to perfection by Amelia Fox, by the way.
Arthur Pendragon, a great destiny awaits you.
She's eventually spirited away, and when she returns in season 3, she's now a full-blown villain who spends the rest of the series trying to overthrow Uther and become queen, with varying degrees of success.
Don't worry, dear brother, I won't let you die alone.
On paper, the idea of showing how Morgana went from benevolent princess to power-hungry villain had lots of potential. The early episodes in season 1 and a couple in season 2 do good jobs at hinting towards her future villainy.
Because I want Uther dead too.
And it's done in a believable way, setting her up as a sheltered palace brat who slowly has her naivety of the world shattered when she sees what Uther is really like.
What have these people done to you? Why are you so full of hate?
Enough.
So what's the problem?
To put the rock shoulders down for free!
In professional wrestling, when a character switches alignments to become a villain, it's called a heel turn. It's normal for a wrestler to have more than one heel turn over the course of their career to keep things fresh. And it's often said that being put over as the biggest fan favourite makes you all the better to be a heel.
If they put you over as the biggest babyface good guy ever,
oh yeah,
that makes you better to be a heel.
Kind of like what they did
with
Eve. You
turn on the crowd and you could be that much more hated.
The biggest turn ever,
Hulk Hogan.
Can I just
actually tell you something?
That is a great feeling.
That was huge. Mm-hmm.
But there are just as many instances where fans haven't accepted a heel turn. A more recent example would be Becky Lynch, who made the switch from face to heel last year.
Too emotional, and it's going to be tough on this grand stage. Oh, Becky!
Part of the problem was that Becky's character has historically been the underdog, often overlooked in favour of her contemporaries like Sasha Banks, Bayley, and Charlotte Flair. Charlotte in particular played the role of the fan favourite, yet came across as unsympathetic and undeserving of another title reign, so Becky turning on her seemed less like a villain move and more like understandable frustration. Pretty much all the fans cheered her on, and at one point WWE tried to edit out the cheers she was getting in all her promos.
I knew in that moment that Charlotte Flair had stolen my spotlight, my opportunity for the last time. I knew in that moment that I was going to raise her hand up and rip her head off.
Morgana's story arc followed similar problems. As someone born with magic powers she didn't want and doesn't know about, she lives in fear that her own stepfather could have her executed.
Uther hates me and everyone like me. Why should I feel any differently about him?
And she slowly sees other innocent people being killed or persecuted just for how they were born. When she first tries to kill Uther in revenge, she can't bring herself to do it.
Are you saying you were wrong to have Tom killed?
Her next attempt on his life is when she helps Morgose cast a spell that puts everyone in Camelot to sleep, so that Morgose can sneak in and murder Uther without hurting anyone else. We'll come back to that. Season 3 sees Morgana becoming the main villain of the show, with Morgose as her right-hand woman. It should be said that Morgana's previous appearance on the show was Season 2's penultimate episode, where she was half in the dark about Morgose's plan.
What do you mean? Whose side are you on, Morgana?
In Season 3's premiere, she's done a complete 180 to become a mustache-twirling Disney witch without a trace of her old self.
Women and children are dying. The city will fall.
Good.
How can this child be your enemy? He's just a boy.
We never find out what happened to her in the year she was missing, whether Morgose brainwashed her, put her under an enchantment, or just strongly convinced her to be evil. And that is a massive problem, because Morgana's switch to cartoon villain makes no sense. She has justifiable reasons to hate Uther and later Merlin, but she freely tortures Arthur and Gwen for no reason other than them being obstacles to her getting the throne. It should be said that she grew up as Arthur's sister. Gwen, likewise, was her best friend and loyal servant.
Dad, I please admit you hate me so much.
You know what you did is what you're destined to do.
For Morgana to be this shamelessly evil, without even a trace of her old self, she had to have been brainwashed or put under some kind of spell.
You execute Gwen's father and I will never forgive you.
Women and children are dying. The city will fall.
Good.
Merlin makes one attempt at talking her down.
It doesn't have to be like this.
And afterwards never considers the possibility that she could be brainwashed or under some kind of spell. The first two seasons establish a close friendship between them.
I'm sorry. It's usually Gwen that has to deal with me when I'm like this.
I don't mind.
Close enough for Morgana to volunteer to help defend his home village. But he never tries to help her or redeem her in any way. She's just written off as evil because the writers say so.
Do you think I deserve to be executed because of who I am?
What makes this more uncomfortable is when Season 5 does a storyline involving Gwen being brainwashed to become evil, which has a lot of parallels with what Morgose did to her.
I spent 2 years living in darkness. I spent 2 years chained to a wall at the bottom of a pit.
Arthur ultimately saves Gwen from this brainwashing, but the idea that Morgana could have possibly gone through the same treatment is never even discussed. Gwen does plenty of evil acts in this persona, but is forgiven, while Morgana is not. The characters just act as if her turning out this way was unavoidable.
No. I'll never be like her.
There are episodes in the first two seasons that foreshadow Morgana being a little less moral than everyone else. In To Kill the King, she never confesses that she gave Tom the key to escape his cell, and her plan of murdering Uther while he's crying at her father's grave is pretty underhanded. In The Nightmare Begins, she's initially willing to let innocent people suffer back in Camelot just so she can stay with the druids.
I'm sorry. I'm never going back.
In The Witchfinder, she also seems like she's okay for Gaius being executed for having magic if he'll keep suspicion of herself. But the latter two points are motivated out of fear for what will happen to her if her magic is exposed. The magic she didn't want in the first place. This serves to make her a flawed protagonist, sure, but not a villain.
What you showed me, is that all you've learned?
For now.
I present to you your undoubted king!
2011 saw a second problematic incarnation of the character on our screens. The Starz series Camelot was King Arthur meets Game of Thrones, but only aired for one season. Morgan is the villain from the first episode, and she spends the whole series trying to undermine Arthur's regime and make herself queen. Despite being the antagonist, pretty much everyone was rooting for her by the end. out of context, the series is about an abuse victim who lost her mother, was banished, confronted her abuser only to get rebuffed, and has her birthright snatched away from her in favour of an immature peasant boy who's no more legitimate than she is. A big part of the problem is how the series presented Arthur, similar to Merlin as a spoiled brat who needs to mature. But in this case, Arthur was too unsympathetic, and Eva Green made Morgan so likeable that not many people cared if Arthur kept the throne. Merlin had similar uncomfortable dichotomies. Let's take a look at Morgana's setup when compared to Uther. She first becomes disillusioned with him when she tries to stop a child from being executed. She's the bad guy. The show does say early on that killing Uther would be bad for the kingdom because it would be plunged into chaos and Arthur isn't ready to become king yet. But more often than not, they just use the "if you kill him, you'll be just like him" trope. Except that Merlin regularly kills his enemies on the show. Take The Witchfinder again, where Merlin frames Aredian for being a sorcerer. Aredian had planted fake evidence himself, but instead of just exposing him as a fraud, Merlin frames him for having magic, which would guarantee his execution in this universe. Sure, there are shades of grey in real life and heroes don't often do heroic things, but it becomes a big problem when put in comparison to Morgana.
Your determination to see goodness in people will be your undoing.
So now we have Kilgara, the wise old dragon that lives underground and gives Merlin advice. This paragon of wisdom tells Merlin that Morgana is an evil witch and shouldn't be trusted.
You speak of the witch, the Lady Morgana.
She's not a witch!
At the point where he says this, Morgana has not done anything evil. The dragon just says she will be evil and Merlin takes him at his word.
She cannot be trusted.
The Nightmare Begins sets up what could have been a good arc of Merlin slowly revealing his powers to Morgana to help her deal with her own.
Maybe I could help?
I doubt that.
He never does because the dragon tells him he shouldn't.
She is dangerous.
He says that Morgana shouldn't know about her powers because she will automatically do bad things with them. And at this point in the series, there's no evidence to support this.
She isn't sure what's happening to her and it's tearing her apart.
The out-of-universe reason is that Morgana was down in the cards to become the series' main villain, so her knowing about Merlin's powers would break the status quo too much. But in the show, it comes across as Merlin keeping his magic hidden to save his own skin rather than helping a friend.
I really wish there was something I could say. I should have listened to you.
And the whole time he and the dragon have this debate, Morgana knows nothing about any of this.
Tell her that her powers aren't something to be afraid of.
Other characters bicker and decide her fate without considering her thoughts or her feelings. She gets no say because the dragon just decides she shouldn't be trusted. And the dragon is the good guy. And that brings us to the penultimate episode of season 2.
The source of this pestilence is the witch, the Lady Morgana.
Morgose puts everyone in Camelot under a sleeping spell so she can sneak in and murder Uther. Morgana is the only one left awake, apart from Arthur and Merlin, who are outside the city on a mission. Merlin gets told by the dragon that Morgana is the source of the magic and she has to die for the spell to break. So Merlin resorts to poisoning Morgana, and she's only saved when Morgose heals her in exchange for breaking the spell. Merlin, our protagonist, tries to kill his friend because someone else told him she was evil.
You're a good friend.
Morgana is not a willing participant in the spell. She has one conversation with Morgose, who knocks her out before she tells her exactly what's going to happen. She has no idea that she is the source of the magic. So Merlin poisons an innocent woman without even telling her. If Merlin told her she had to die for the spell to break, there's a good chance she would have taken the poison willingly. Or else, not wanting to die could have set up a good reason for her to turn against Merlin. Merlin could offer her the chance to do the right thing, and when she doesn't take it, this forces his hand. The way it happens in the episode falls flat because Morgana is the victim here. She's a victim of Merlin, Gaius, Morgose, and Kilgara, and yet she's presented as irredeemably evil from this point onward. Merlin never goes out of his way to apologize or atone for doing this either. In the season finale, we get this line:
I blame myself for what you've become.
But it's not much of a payoff. There are lots of parallels between Morgana's character arc and the similarly criticized end of Daenerys Targaryen in season 8 of Game of Thrones. Both characters start off as victims of a patriarchal society, and they're both introduced as likable and heroic. Any character flaws they have are nothing in comparison to those of the other protagonists.
Dracarys.
Morgana wanting Uther dead is motivated out of the fact that he's a tyrant who would kill her if he knew the truth about her. The message that it's wrong to kill your enemies falls flat compared to the amount of times that Merlin has killed his own enemies on the show. And he's been treated as sympathetic for doing so. Both Morgana and Daenerys make a heel turn to become the villain of the series, but neither time is earned. So the writers overcompensate by making the evil acts go to extremes that are completely inconsistent with their previous characterization. Daenerys burns an entire city to the ground when not too long ago she chained both her dragons underground because of the accidental death of one child.
How old was she?
Three.
Morgana randomly murders civilians and innocent people and tries to do the same to her brother and best friend, characters she had an established bond with. Morgana's reasons are hinted, but never really explained.
How could you hope to understand?
I do understand, believe me.
The reason? Merlin has to remain sympathetic to the audience. See this scene where Morgana confronts Merlin about what he did to her?
Because I don't understand how anyone would want to hurt their friends.
No, you just poison them.
She kinda has a point here.
Just think how Uther would react if he learned that a serving boy had tried to poison his beloved ward.
But we have to have her as the villain, so of course she murders innocent guards and tries to torture Uther. There's also the driving question that the show never answers. What did Morgose do to her?
A canna slips wiltshire there.
A year passes between seasons 2 and 3, and we never find out exactly what happened to Morgana. And the reason is that doing so would only make Morgana more sympathetic.
You tried to poison me.
I didn't want to.
She had to have been brainwashed, enchanted, or possibly tortured, as Gwen was in season 5. But the writers wanted Morgana to be an irredeemable villain, so they just don't tell us what made Morgana this way in the hopes that we don't ask and just take it as given.
It's over, Morgana.
No, you're wrong. This has just begun!
This is also why the other characters' reactions to Morgana's heel turn are extremely downplayed. Merlin isn't surprised when he discovers this, and neither is Gaius. When Gwen finds this out, she immediately suspects that she's up to some evil plan, never questioning why she would do such a thing.
I don't know what cruel trick you're playing, but I will not be broken by you.
But the characters never question why Morgana would do this, because that would invite the audience to as well. And it would show that Morgana isn't evil because she chose it or society made her this way. She's only evil because the writers say so. The problem of Morgana is the same as the problem of Susan. You have a female character who does a complete 180 from her previous benevolent characterization, and it all happens off-screen with secondhand information is all you get. While the criticism towards Susan is misplaced, it's the execution that's the problem. Morgana is far more problematic.
No mortal blade can kill me.
This is no mortal blade.
This is a female character who is robbed of any agency in her own story, with her fate being dictated by the males around her. The only reason she becomes the villain is because everyone expects her to be and treats her as such.
Can't be.
I have warned you about her in the past, but you have failed to take heed.
Merlin attempted to do a more modern take on Morgan le Fay than the typical Wicked Witch characterization, but it sadly fell very flat. The real shame is that Katie McGrath seemed to understand her own character better than the writers did. She tried and tried to keep Morgana consistent the whole series, and even when the writers weren't trying, she at least tried to have fun in the role.
I would have sold my soul for someone to show me kindness such as this.
The same with Eva Green in Camelot. Suppose when it comes to more nuanced takes on Morgan le Fay, I guess I'll have to get around to writing that Knights of Camelot series I've been talking about since 2013. See.
It's good to have you back.
Thank you, Merlin.